Now he moves down in that to their present state and condition. And we have here in verse 13, "Now therefore, behold the king whom ye have chosen and whom ye have desired. And behold, the Lord hath set a king over you." Now Samuel makes it very clear that Saul was the people's choice. Now, I want to be very careful in saying this, but we've been brought up, so many of us, and made to believe that the voice of the majority, the voice of the people, is the voice of God. May I say to you, the Bible contradicts that. The Bible says it's generally the minority. We're living in a day when we've heard a great deal from the minorities. Well, the very interesting thing is God has always moved in that direction. Martin Luther said, though one with God is a majority, and God generally moves with the one. And the people wanted Saul. God is the one who chose David. What a difference when God makes the choice. Now, will you notice verse 14? But because he is the people's choice, God will not reject him. God's going to give him an opportunity. Verse 14, "If ye will fear the Lord and serve him and obey his voice and not rebel against the commandment of the Lord, then shall both ye and also the king that reigneth over you continue following the Lord your God." God will bless you, you see. Now, verse 15, "But if ye will not obey the voice of the Lord, but rebel against the commandment of the Lord, then shall the hand of the Lord be against you as it was against your fathers." And so we find that at this time, Samuel tells it like it is. He says, if you will serve God, God's going to bless you, though you made this choice yourself. But if you do not, judgment will come. Now we find that God does respond to this in a very dramatic and, I think, miraculous way. "Now therefore stand and see great things which the Lord will do before your eyes." Verse 16. "Is it not wheat harvest today? I'll call unto the Lord, and he shall send thunder and rain, that ye may perceive and see that your wickedness is great, which ye have done in the sight of the Lord in asking you a king. So Samuel called unto the Lord, and the Lord sent thunder and rain that day, and all the people greatly feared the Lord and Samuel." Now, this man Elijah was not the first that could preach up a storm, as I hear some folks say today. He could bring in a thunderstorm. Well, Elijah did it later, but Samuel did it before he did. And this is God's seal, I think, upon Samuel's life. God is putting the great amen on the life of Samuel, that Samuel was definitely God's choice. Now, will you note here, verse 19, "And all the people said unto Samuel, pray for thy servants unto the Lord thy God, that we die not. For we have added unto all our sins this evil, to ask us a king." Now, the asking of a king on the part of these people was sin. It was actually rejecting God and wanting someone to rule over them, like the nations round about. Now listen, though, to Samuel as he speaks to these people. Verse 20, "Samuel said unto the people, fear not, ye've done all this wickedness, yet turn not aside from following the Lord, but serve the Lord with all your heart. And don't, friends, let past sins spoil your life, or past mistakes spoil your life. I don't care who you are and what you've done. May I say to you, don't let the past destroy the future for you and ruin the present. My move out today for God, my Christian friend." Now, we find in verse 21, "And turn ye not aside, for then shall ye go after vain things, which cannot profit nor deliver, for they are vain." Hold to the Lord. Let the gimmicks alone. Today, the church is experimenting with gimmicks, with methods. And they don't seem to realize that it's God today that alone can bless. And we need to hold on to him. And that means to hold on to the Word of God. I don't think the Word of God needs defending. It needs explaining. It needs today to be proclaimed. And that, we believe, is the important thing. We need more of the exclamation point and the declaration, more than we need the question mark today.